Mark is a political activist. He continues to be a political activist while in prison. He's now fighting for the right to have non-English literature and letters, for instance, because the prison authorities have denied him and other prisoners the right to have them. And he needs these written materials so he can continue to collaborate with fellow fighters from the Philippines to Sweden to be a part of the worldwide struggle for freedom and justice. And it's so ironic because this is exactly why they framed him up. Exactly why they beat him, called him a Mexican lover like you love those coloreds, because he had the audacity to speak Spanish and to defend immigrant workers. That's why he's serving 25 years in prison today.
Well, I left New York City, where I was living, for Des Moines in November of 86. But it wasn't the first time I'd been to Iowa. Several months preceding that, I'd been out to participate in some of the demonstrations and rallies that took place around the strike against the Hormel Company in Austin, Minnesota, the P9 strike, as it was called. And that strike was pretty, was a flashpoint, a lightning rod, really, for a number of battles that were happening, just beginning in meatpacking all over this area in the Midwest. Meatpacking is a changing industry right now. It's dominated by a few large corporations, and they are an all-out drive to drive the value of labor power down among workers in this industry. And concretely, what that means for working people is a cut in wages, the several dollars an hour cut they wanted to take in Austin. What they wanted to do in the plant that I was working at, Swift, take $2 and $3 an hour away from you. At the same time, a tremendous speed up in the line. Job combinations, making one person do two or three jobs. The line speed alone was going so fast that workers were not able to keep up. They were cutting themselves with the knives they used, cutting each other, injuring themselves by slipping on the floor. Many got a disease of the wrist called carpal tunnel syndrome. Amputations, terrible injuries were taking place at the same time. Money was going down. It was coming out of people's backs, literally. And the situation had reached the point where people said, I can't take any more and I want to fight back any way I can.
Then these Hormel workers got tired of it. They got tired of what the Hormel company was doing to them, which is what packing house bosses all around the Midwest and throughout this country have been doing to packing house workers. Now these workers who fought like this came up against unbelievable odds. They came up against enemies they didn't think they had. They thought the government was neutral. They thought the government would stand aside and watch them fight the employers and allow them to use their power, their right to withhold their labor power to win their demands from the employers. But they found the government was on the side of the employers. The governor of Minnesota sent out the National Guard, the state cops, the local cops, even private cops were used against the workers in the packing industry. In fact, at a forum I spoke at in February of 1987, a private cop admitted at the NLRB hearing that he spied on the meeting where packing house fighters from all over the Midwest had come to a public forum to discuss the fight in the packing industry. But they did. They faced all these enemies, but they fought. And because they fought, they inspired working people in the Midwest and throughout this country. They were able to go out of Austin, Minnesota, reach out into the state as a whole, reach out into the Midwest, reach out to workers throughout this country and even in the world with their struggle. And as a result of them doing that, they inspired other workers to fight in a way they had not fought for over 8-9 years in this country.
At Swift, I worked on the kill floor. It's a hard job. It's very hot in the summer, very humid. The line moves very rapidly. 2,400 cattle a day is what we kill. My main job was pulling paunches, which the cow stomach comes down the line. You have to cut the pec, which is part of the stomach, off, and heave it onto another line where it can be processed or tried. These stomachs weigh 50, 100 pounds, and they're coming at you several thousand every day, several every minute, and it's a hard job. One day I pulled the muscles in my upper back out, pulling one of the bigger stomachs off the line. And I had to be recovered from that injury before I could do any more work. When I pulled it out again, when they put me back on the job too soon, I told the boss that I had to go to the doctor, that I had to see some medical attention, and the boss flat out refused to send me to the doctor. Eventually the pain got so bad that I just walked off the line telling him I had to see the doctor. The boss told me that if you leave, you'll be fired, and I was fired for taking care of my body, my most important thing that I really have, which is what I used to make a living with. So that happens a lot. But what was unusual in my case was I was able to fight and win my job back. I went to my coworkers, I went to the union chief steward, and we waged a fight to get my job back, not just on my behalf, but for everybody. And I think it was a victory, not just for me.
The packing houses are constantly looking for new workers. In many cases, they have turned to the most desperate. And Bill Schmitz, a Sioux City union leader and second-generation meat packer, believes history is repeating itself.
This industry has always depended upon refugees. The big plants, the big packing houses, brought the blacks, they brought the Poles, they brought groups in. Now they moved on to a new refugee group, which were the Southeast Asians. First the Vietnamese came, and now the Laotians came. I believe that group's almost used up now, too.
They're a special target to keep out of the union. And they'd like whites and black workers to think that these recent immigrants don't have a place in the union. They don't have a place in Des Moines or in Iowa or the country as a whole, that they're so-called wetbacks, and that they're taking your job, and that they'll work for less, and they're the real cause of what's making things bad here at Swift.
The point I was making about how they pit workers of different nationality against each other, I had an experience where I worked right across from me. I worked from a couple of women, Southeast Asian women, and our foreman, who was white, he was teaching these two women who didn't speak really very much English at all how to say wetback in English in order to say it to a Mexican coworker of mine down the belt who we didn't like.
A year ago, yesterday, the Immigration and Naturalization Service, the INS, police came to Iowa, came to Des Moines to conduct a raid. They came in one morning while we were at work. They went down the line, grabbing people that they wanted, people with dark skin, people who were obviously Hispanic. They took them into the locker room, they got their clothes, they got handcuffed, and they were taken away to jail.
It was obvious that they picked a backwater, small, insignificant little city like Des Moines in their thinking, and probably they hoped that they wouldn't get as much publicity generated or any reaction whatsoever. In one hand, they were trying to coax people into applying for the amnesty program with the idea that eventually they would become naturalized citizens and be here legally. And on the other hand, once a person would apply for amnesty, they would be there with essentially a bat waiting to prosecute the individual.
And 3 days later, on March 4th, a protest meeting was called to take place 2 p.m. on March the 4th. And many of the workers at Swift wanted to go, were ready to go. And the company initially told them that they could attend this meeting. Then at lunchtime, around noon hour, the company did an about-face. They told workers that they could not go to the 2 o'clock meeting, that they were going to have to stay and work the rest of that day out. Well, that was just the final straw for most people. There was a discussion about it over the lunch period, and they decided, what use is it to stay here and wait for the next raid to take place? We're not doing anything for our brothers who are in jail. We're not doing anything for ourselves. Let's do something about it. So they walked out at 2 o'clock. The word was passed, and people put down their knives and just walked to the locker room. this was a big disruption for production. And every single minute that the line's down, it's costing the company, in their view, a lot of money. So they scrambled right away to get things going again, like they always do anytime the line shuts down. They ran into the locker room. They contacted people who were organizing this meeting, and they got a second meeting scheduled for a time that we could go to late that afternoon. At the earlier meeting, an idea for a demonstration was raised, and we discussed having a march in Des Moines to protest the arrest of the 17. I spoke at the meeting, spoke in Spanish, added my views, which was to try and get the union more involved in supporting this protest and to get other workers from the plant involved.
After he left that meeting, he went to Los Compadres Bar and Restaurant, which is located right next to the Swift plant, to talk about the arrest and the events that had taken place. There were a lot of people at Los Compadres and a lot of excitement about the Mexican workers shutting down the kill floor. And he talked up the idea of people coming to the protest and march that had been called. He left Los Compadres and went home. He called me. It was about 8:45. I live right next door to Mark. He called to tell me that he was expecting two friends from out of town who he was supposed to put up, but he had to run out to the grocery store to buy food for the next day's militant labor forum on Nicaragua. One of the friends was scheduled to speak at this forum, that he would probably get back before they arrived, but just in case, he wanted me to look out for them, and if they arrived before he returned, that I should put them up until he got back.
I left the house, but I never made it to the grocery store that night, because on my way, as I was stopped at a traffic light a few blocks from my house, a young woman ran up to my car. She pounded on the hood. She said that she was in need of some help, basically pleaded with me to give her a ride to her house because she claimed that a man down the street had a bar, kind of a notorious tough spot in Des Moines, was after her, was trying to hurt her, and would I give her a ride to her house? It was only a few blocks away, she said. Which I agreed to. I didn't really think twice about it, about helping somebody like that who needed some help. So I let her in the car. I took her to her house, which, like she said, was a few blocks away, and was prepared to let her out there. But then she asked me if I'd come up to the house itself, because she was afraid, she said, of this guy who might be there, who might be hiding in the shadows, and so on. So we got up there to her doorstep. And she said, just wait here on the porch while I check the house out. Well, she went inside in the house. I've never seen that woman again since that night, since she walked into that door. But what happened then was really the beginning of the nightmare that put me in here, because just a few minutes after she went inside, I was arrested. A big bang happened at the porch door behind me. Cop came in. I jumped out of his way, and he grabbed me by the arm. He hollered out, "I've got him." And I thought initially, this is a mistake. They're thinking that I'm the guy who's chasing after this woman. Well, they took me into the house, grabbed me by the arm, marched me inside, handcuffed me behind my back, handcuffed my wrists behind my back. Sat me down on the bed in their bedroom and unbuckled my pants, pulled them halfway down and said, "Let's see what we've got here." Then he told me that I was under arrest. He took my wallet, my keys, and marched me outside. I was forced to hold my pants up, marched me outside, put me in a police car, and I was taken to the city jail. At that time, I was charged with second degree sexual abuse. And in the paper the next day, there's an article about an arrest of an attempted rapist who came to the house that I was at, asked for directions, and attempted to rape a 15-year-old girl. And a lucky call to the police on the 911 line saved the day. Well, of course, I didn't know this at the time, and because my wife was at work, I called a neighbor told her that I was under arrest. I asked what the charges were, and they told me sexual abuse. Then I was taken into a room off the main booking area and had a little interrogation by the police. First, I took my clothes, put them in a paper bag, paper sack.
They took all your clothes?
I was handcuffed with my hands behind my back. And the police, another older officer came in, had a tape recorder, set it on the desk where I was, and started talking about what had happened and saying, you were raping that girl, you're gonna have to face up to this, and so on. Well, naturally, I wouldn't do anything like that or even talk to the guy who was obviously trying to badger me. Eventually, that was clear to them that I wasn't going to say anything. And the cop said, well, you're just one of those Mexican lovers, aren't you? Just like you love those coloreds. At that point, I said, I don't have to take this. I stood up and I got myself a beating. One officer grabbed me from behind, who was standing behind me, grabbed me around the neck in a chokehold. They pulled me down to the floor, and another officer jumped on top of me and hit me across my face with a nightstick. He broke my cheekbone with that. I had to get 15 stitches when I was taken to the hospital. And evidently I was beaten further because I had bruises all over my body.
The city jail, which is where he told us he was, said they had nobody there by that name. Try the county jail. We called the county jail. They said they had nobody by that name. Called the city jail. The third call to the city jail, they said, well, maybe we're processing somebody in the back. Call back in 20 minutes. That was when they were beating him up. They called it processing somebody in the back. They, of course, knew who it was right from the beginning. Finally, after an hour of calling and getting these obvious lies, I just went down there to the city jail. I went up to there's a glass window there, the cop sitting behind it. I told them I wanted to get Mark Curtis out of jail. They started laughing. They said, well, do you have $30,000 in cash in your pocket? We finally did get him out of jail the next day when about half a dozen of us signed our cars over to the bondsman and we borrowed enough money to make the bond so that we were able to bail him out. He'd been beaten very severely. We got him home. I took the picture of him that's been seen around the world, the picture of this is what police justice in Des Moines, Iowa is like. When we heard about Mark's arrest, we knew about the political framework this was in immediately, of course. He'd just been at the meeting protesting the immigration raid. There was a walkout at Swift the same day. He was well known among the, particularly among the immigrant workers, and he had a crisis developing around this. What we found out within the next few weeks added to this political framework that we knew right from the beginning. One is we found out right away that there was no medical evidence connecting Mark to the alleged victim. After Mark's arrest, people working with CISPIS in New York and looking through the thousands of files that had been turned over to them found that there was a file on Mark, which none of us knew about. Mark didn't know about it until after his arrest. And they sent the file to us right away. So then we actually had an FBI file targeting Mark. The file's funny because in a stupid way, the FBI spies write their reports. What it accuses him of is, quote, advocating peace, not just the absence of war, but peace. This is Mark's crime, which got him an FBI file.
Not only CISPIS, there were over 120 organizations that were spied on. So we understand what happens when you are doing effective political work, that the FBI, through the agencies of the federal government, their campaigns launched by the government to try to discredit the organizations and the people that are being effective in doing educating people and organizing people for our rights.
The protest march the following Saturday was a very cold day. Mark was still in very weak shape, but he attended the march. He wasn't able to walk the whole distance from the Mexican American Center to the plaza downtown. And at that rally, he was interviewed by the news media about what had happened, and he talked to many other people about what had happened. We organized a open house at the bookstore here at the Milton Labor Forum, invited people to come to hear about what had happened to Mark. And this was really the beginning of the Mark Curtis Defense Committee.
The Defense Committee is made up really of a pretty much a cross-section of people in Des Moines. There are a couple of us that are federal employees, civil rights leaders, there are farmers, a lot of union people, and obviously a lot of people from the Socialist Workers Party, which is Mark's party. But the common interest is not the thing we have in common is that we all believe in democratic rights, the right to speak and stand up for what you believe in.
You might say I got involved with the Mark Curtis Defense Committee starting from ground zero, because the first newspaper article that I read was the Register's version, story of the police's version of what happened. And I want to be honest, my first reaction is, my God, what have we got across the street from us? And the day after his arrest, they drove him up in front of his house, and when he got out, he looked like he'd been in a terrible accident. And for the first time then, I began, instead of thinking about everybody else, I started thinking about Mark, and I felt compassion for him. And I wanted to know, something was terribly wrong, and I wanted to know what was going on in my city.
I think my first words were, well, this sounds like the Des Moines police. Let's investigate and see what's going on.
They have what they call an elevator ride. It's so well known that people in Des Moines and around Iowa know about it and joke about it, that if you're in the Des Moines police station and you get on that elevator, you may be in a lot worse shape by the time you get off that elevator.
They'll sit up and take notes. A lot of people don't want to believe this story. They don't believe the police do things like this, but they do. It's always been known that they get them in that elevator and box them around. But what can he do? If a man goes to court with a black eye, they say, well, he fell and hurt himself. That's the end of it. You don't hear it no more.
I investigated further, and I got to find out, through the media as well as through my experience on the commission, that indeed there was a great deal wrong, that appeared to be wrong in the police department, i.e. the sexism case that appeared in federal court, the allegations of racism by none other than a police cadet, two police cadets. Chief Mulder and the police department started to, instead of dealing with them constructively, started circling the wagons and essentially continuing their strategy of stonewalling. And when I say the police department, that extended all the way to the city manager and the city council. There was no convincing, even confirmation or admission that there possibly might be something wrong here, and that the Curtis case had actually become a catalyst for a number of things to come out.
A Des Moines man accused of attempted rape and burglary today launched an elaborate campaign to build public support for himself. Political activist Mark Curtis held what he called a defense rally to protest the charges against him. TV8's Chris Lidstad reports the rally is stirring up as much controversy as the emotional case itself.
Victory. This rally called together representatives of political groups across the globe, from the African National Congress to the NAACP. Flyers and posters demand charges against Mark Curtis be dropped.
We are here to demand justice for Mark Curtis.
So we had a second international rally in September, and the attendance at that was over 400 people, supporters from around the world. Edna Griffin, a Des Moines civil rights leader, spoke at the rally.
I think I made a statement somewhere that this case is not about rape, that it's about the immigrant workers.
Farm leader Carol Niemeyer, civil rights leaders from Iowa City, and Central America activists.
I see Mark as a political prisoner, and the same thing happens in El Salvador where people are abused, they're tortured. I see Mark as being tortured. We don't like to use that word per se, but the fact is he was tortured by the police.
Hector Marroquin spoke, Puerto Rican poet Perry Thomas. There were just a tremendous outpouring of support at this rally, and we went into the trial at the end of that rally with on a very upbeat note because of the support that we had gained.
Today's trial takes place in the Polk County Courthouse in Des Moines, Iowa. The case will be heard by a 12-person jury. Iowa law prevents the showing of jury members on camera. Judge Harry Perkins is presiding. Judge Perkins has been on the bench for 23 years. He was previously the Polk County Attorney. The prosecutor is Assistant County Attorney Kathy Tune. She's been practicing law since 1982. Defense Attorney Mark Pennington has been in private practice for 9 years. He was previously an Assistant Polk County Attorney who specialized in prosecuting sex crimes.
From the outset, it was clear that the state of Iowa wanted to treat this case as an ordinary garden variety criminal case. They, in fact, anticipated our political defense, and they anticipated that by filing some pretrial motions. These motions were to keep out any reference of FBI surveillance of Mark Curtis. They were to keep out evidence of the beating, evidence of slander to him that indicated that they knew the type of work that he did. All these matters were filed by the state.
And what Mark has said, in essence, is this. The state of Iowa anticipated from the very outset that this indeed was a case that involved politics.
The prosecution calls the 15-year-old victim of the alleged sexual attack. Because of her age and the nature of the charge, her name is being withheld and her appearance disguised. Defense attorney Mark Pennington cross-examines. He questions her about the time of the incident.
We realize if someone was there at 7:35, that person could not have been Mark Curtis.
I don't know that.
On the night of the incident, Rose Floyd says she received a phone call from the defendant. The victim has testified that Mark Curtis arrived at her home at 7:35 and stayed there until just before 10.
When was the first call, if you know?
The first call was around 8:45.
Tell the jury why you believe that it was at 8:45 as opposed to some other time.
Well, I'm pretty certain that it was around 8:45 because at the time he called me, as I said, I was awakened. And I worked midnight, so it was natural for me to want to know how much more time I had to sleep before I got up to go to work. And so I say around 8:45 because it could have been a little before because I looked after the call.
So by the time when you hung up the phone, you looked at the clock, it was 8:45.
Yes.
The second call must have been after Mr. Curtis was arrested.
He called me from jail.
That's all I have on direct.
Brian Willie is another friend of Mark Curtis. He claims to have actually been with the defendant part of the time on the night the incident was alleged to have taken place.
Brian, did you see Mark Curtis on that night?
Later on, he came in, yeah, about 7 o'clock.
Okay. How long was Mark there?
I think he left around 8:30.
Why do you think he left at 8:30?
Because I had to meet some people at 9 o'clock, so I kept looking at my watch.
The witnesses came into court and actually testified under oath that Mr. Curtis was with them at the time that she alleged he was breaking into her house trying to attack her or assault her. At the conclusion of the trial, Mr. Pennington made a record requesting that the trial court give an instruction on alibi, which is traditionally the instruction that if the state has failed to prove that the defendant was where the state alleges the defendant was, that the jury can consider that and should consider it. And we believe that if the jury had been allowed to consider that alibi instruction, there would have been a different outcome in this case.
Prosecution witness Paul Bush is a forensic specialist with the Des Moines Police Department. He examined Mark Curtis's clothes for evidence of sexual contact with the alleged victim.
What were the results of your analysis?
As far as these items of clothing are concerned, no seminal fluid was detected.
11.
The witness went on to testify that in the examination of the victim's clothing, no seminal fluid or pubic hair other than her own were found. The defense then cross-examines about the significance of this evidence.
Can you tell me how that bit of evidence, which you testified earlier, in any way connects this Caucasian, Mr. Curtis, to a sexual attack on...
That evidence, as far as I'm concerned, does not tie either two together. That's all.
There was no hair that matched Mark Curtis. Any hair found was dissimilar to that of Mark Curtis on the victim. In addition, Mark Curtis' clothes were checked for any type of body hair. There was certainly no body hair on Mark Curtis that resembled or could have come from the victim.
Are you sure that the individual that attacked you had a belt?
Yes, I could hear it when he was taking it off.
So there would have been a belt seized at the scene then, would there not?
Yeah.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
That this person took off his belt. Well, I didn't even have a belt on or any such thing.
Officer Gonzalez, you didn't retrieve a belt from Mr. Curtis, did you?
No.
You're pretty sure that the individual who attacked you or who certainly came to your door had smoke on his breath?
Yes, you could smell it. I could.
I take it you've been around other people that smoke and know what that smells like.
Yeah.
Ever known Mark Curtis to smoke cigarettes?
He is a non-smoker. He gets on my case because I am a smoker.
Well, there were certainly some factual inconsistencies by the victim herself. She indicated that the attacker was 5'6". Mark Curtis is 6'1", and certainly mistakes can be made concerning estimates of someone's height. However, we're talking about a considerable difference in height, 5'6" to 6'1".
So when testified that you were the person that raped her, she's lying.
You know, I heard her here Monday, like you did, like we all did, and I believe something may have happened to her, maybe even what she said, but I was not that person, and she is wrong about that much, I know for a fact. What else might have happened to her, I don't know, I can't say, but I can say that I was not the person.
And so she's making it up.
She's wrong. Let me just put it that way. Because I don't know her motives or if she's had time to think about it or if something happened previously. I just don't know. I just don't know, and I'm not going to speculate on it.
Officer Joe Gonzalez was one of two officers dispatched to the victim's house in response to the 911 call. He testifies about what happened when he arrived.
What was that person doing?
He was pulling up his pants.
What happened then?
The young girl yelled, "He just raped me."
Then what happened?
The man inside took off running. One of them grabbed me by the arm and said, "I've got him." At this point, I thought that there might be a misunderstanding here, that in fact she had called the police worried about this guy who was after her, and that the police officers thought that I was the guy.
What happened?
Well, he grabbed me by the elbow and walked me through the living room into this bedroom here in the back of the house. I caught up with the man in the back bedroom.
What happened then?
After I handcuffed him, I advised him to reach down with his hands and pull his pants up, hold on to him, and then I had him sit down on the bed. He handcuffed me, my wrists behind my back, turned me around, sat me down on this bed that was there. He pushed me back onto the bed, and he unbuckled my pants and pulled them down. He asked me, "What do you have on me so far?"
Did you say anything to him?
I said, "What are you doing to me?" And he said,
Let's see what we've got here. Let's see what you've done.
We made a motion to produce the personnel file of Officer Gonzalez. That was denied by the court. Despite the denial, through the investigation that was conducted, we're able to find out that Officer Gonzalez had been suspended for lying about a police incident. Officer Gonzalez had previously been suspended by his own police department chief for lying about matters in a police report. That goes to his very credibility. When you're trying to convince 12 jurors here in Des Moines, Iowa, that a police officer was involved in a frame-up, you certainly should be allowed to present to that jury evidence that he had lied in the past. It's up to the jury to make the decision where he's lying today involving Mark Curtis, whether he was lying at trial. But how can they make that determination unless they have all the facts before them? And it was our position to the court, and it was argued very strenuously, that that matter should be brought to the jury's attention. And we were not allowed to bring before the jury the fact that he had been suspended for lying, and we felt that was severely handicapped the defense.
Mr. Curtis, you told this jury you're an honest person, is that right?
That's right.
Could you tell the jury why you left Hayes International in 1985?
Yes, I was fired from Hayes International.
Isn't it true that you were fired because you falsified your application?
No, that's not the case at all.
And isn't it true that you put down on an application that you had prior experience in companies that did not exist?
I did do that.
And you lied on that document then?
This was during the height of the recession, and I put down a little extra experience to help me get that job.
And that's all that they could find to bring before the jury. In his entire past record was that one statement.
In other words, there are no previous convictions, no previous arrests, nothing that they could come up with.
No, there was nothing. And more than not having a conviction or arrest, they couldn't find anybody who could contradict the character testimony. Certainly, if someone acted in the manner which the state alleged, and I made this point in closing argument, that is, to have acted so impulsively, to have knocked on a door, and when a young black girl answered the door, be so carried away and have so little impulse control that the need was there to try and take that young girl and to forcibly rape her on the floor of their own home where there is another child present in the home. If this kind of activity occurred, then isn't it logical that sometime in his life he has shown similar impulse control? The fact that the state of Iowa was able to obtain information concerning a false statement in an application for a former job in the state of Alabama, to me, tells me a great deal. It certainly tells me that they spent a great deal of time and effort and money to try and find out what they could concerning Mark Curtis's background, and shows that they came up short. All the king's men of the state of Iowa, and all they could find was a false statement on an employment application.
The jury has returned.
State of Iowa plaintiff versus Mark Stanton Curtis, defendant. Form number one, as to count one, we the jury find the defendant, Mark Stanton Curtis, guilty of sexual abuse in the third degree as charged in the trial information. Count two, form number one, we the jury find the defendant, Mark Stanton Curtis, guilty of burglary in the first degree as charged in the trial information.
Just think, in this case here, had the jury been given the evidence that we've just talked about, the racial remarks, the politics, the beating, all those sorts of things, clearly in my mind, the jury would have acquitted Mark Curtis.
The biggest problem for the prosecution was, even though they got a conviction, it wasn't convincing politically. So the defense office remained a beehive of activity, and we continued to find people had an open mind and were willing to support the defense. I remember the morning the conviction was announced in the news, they had a talk show on what was your opinion of the verdict. And more than half of the people who called in said they weren't convinced that Curtis was guilty at all.
And I was shocked when the jury had found him guilty.
And I was, I thought he was innocent by the time the trial started. By the time the trial was over, I knew he was innocent.
And after I got involved in this, I got more involved, the extent I watched the whole trial through its whole proceedings. And the more I seen the trial, the more I was convinced. I was convinced I was positive that Mark did not get a fair trial.
And one of the strongest groups supporting Mark in Iowa have been the farmers. That is, the farmers have been involved in fights themselves to save their land, got a taste of what the criminal justice system is. We're on our way up to Harold Dunkelberger's farm, who's an activist in American agriculture movement. And like many farmers, going through the injustices of the criminal justice system.
Well, it's strictly in the courts now. I'm going through the foreclosure process, and I'm fighting it with all my strength and ability. Just about a distinct parallel with what Mark has gone through, denying us our rights and holding out information that they won't allow to be used.
We have all kinds of incidents where justice is not just being served. And one particular thing that always comes to mind is Daryl Ringer, a farmer out in Kansas. And he went before the judge, and the first thing the judge told him was, listen, when you come before this court against the bank, you're wrong. I welcome the opportunity and the responsibility to defend Mark Curtis and to defend anybody that is being victimized because of their political ideas. And I think that it's important that everyone stand up.
So in December, we launched the endorser drive. And within 3 or 4 months, we'd actually gotten over 3,000 endorsers of people who'd taken a public position, lending their support to the case. And that included at least 500 or 700 very prominent activists from around the country. And many of those activists helped us in many ways. We had rallies over that time period in different parts of the country, as well as here in Des Moines. We had a teach-in here in Des Moines, which featured Sammy Roberts, who's state president for Alabama now.
We have a legal system, but we don't have a justice system. And if they call it a justice system, it is one that doesn't give a tinker's damn about women, children, and men like Mark Curtis or any other political activist in this country.
We also had Lorenzo Irvin, who was a former political prisoner himself.
Prisons are concentration camps for the black, poor, and other minorities. They're not there as instruments to protect society. That's the biggest fallacy and myth that they like to perpetrate. They're not there for that at all, any more than Mark Curtis is in prison for a rape case. This case is not about rape at all. This is about political repression.
Hollis Watkins was another one, who's a longtime civil rights activist. That's been one part of this. We've had many prominent civil rights activists take a position on the case.
So tonight, I will join you with a public endorsement of the Mark Curtis.
And also people such as Eastern strikers, trade union leaders, women's rights activists, and so forth.
Prison is not the place for Mark Curtis. Prison is not a place for anyone who stands for justice.
We have support groups in Canada, Great Britain, France, Sweden, Australia, New Zealand. I went to Sweden and I visited 5 cities, and in Stockholm I met Bernadette Devlin McCalliskey, who is a freedom fighter from Northern Ireland, and we also did a lot of street petitioning and letting people know about the Mark Curtis Defense Campaign on the streets of Stockholm.
In the last couple of weeks I was able to go to Britain to represent the Mark Curtis Defense Committee.
It's not just Mark Curtis, it could happen to anybody. Anybody in our trade union, in other trade unions, anywhere in the world.
In New Zealand, I went to 5 cities, and I visited with trade union leaders, members of parliament. I actually was invited to parliament to speak with one of the members of parliament there. And in Auckland, there was a big rally that the supporters there organized for me. And one of the speakers was Jock Barnes, who's an 83-year-old veteran workers' rights fighter.
It was a privilege for me to have this opportunity of voicing my protest, and with it the thousands of New Zealanders who in the past and today have shown they are prepared to fight for freedom and justice. We say, release Mark Curtis.
I want to review briefly some of the recent experiences of the Mark Curtis Defense Committee that we've all been part of, and the challenges that we've been taking on. First, the fact that we've been fighting to get the non-English letters, correspondence, and the right to share literature. And the battle around that, we were able to go back to people and talk to them about the political character of this frame-up, why they would be interested in denying Mark Curtis, the so-called Mexican lover, a Spanish-English dictionary and non-English materials, and how this went to the heart of the case of someone like Mark who defends immigrant rights and was fighting to unify the working class. In the rally that we had before Mark went to trial last September, he said that he would fight in prison as a political activist in the same way that he had been fighting before. Well, he's doing just that, and he's doing it magnificently.
Are you optimistic now, or are you pretty much just resigned to being behind these bars?
No, I'll never be resigned to being behind these bars. I'm very optimistic, and I see real gains being made in this fight. I really believe that we are winning. They have not been able to crush me underfoot. They've not been able to stop me from telling the truth. They've not been able to stop me from being a political person. They've not been able to stop the fight for justice in this case. And they will not be able to stop the fight for justice anywhere else. And as long as I'm a part of that fight, as long as others continue to join that fight, be it in this country, be it in Palestine, be it in Central America, I'll never lose faith.